Is she really going out with him?
Everybody, and welcome to the second episode of the UKPNW at 40 podcast. UKPNW stands for United Kingdom Punk and New Wave. My name is Bill Zanowitz, and I'm your host for this podcast, which celebrates UKPNW on the event of its 40th anniversary. On our first episode, I detailed the TV debut of the Sex Pistols on September 4th, 1976. This episode is being released on September 21st, 2016, which happens to be the 40th anniversary of the final day of the 100 Club Punk Special, which took place at the 100 Club on Oxford Street in London on the 20th and 21st of September 1976. This two-day event, sometimes referred to as the 100 Club Punk Festival, is in retrospect one of the most important evenings in London's live music history. Attracting almost 600 attendees to the tiny jazz club, the bill included 8 punk rock bands, nearly all of whom were unsigned at the time, and the concert signaled that punk was moving from being a completely underground movement into something that was attracting much more mainstream attention. So who were the acts that played this historic event? There were the Sex Pistols as the headliners, along with The Clash, The Damned, The Vibrators with special guest Chris Spedding, The Buzzcocks, a female-fronted band from France named Stinky Toys, and it also marked the debut performances of both Subway Sect and Siouxsie and the Banshees. Now, I'm not going to go into any great detail regarding the early history of the bands that played at this event. I'm going to reserve that for episodes which cover their first vinyl releases or their first significant radio sessions. That'll be down the road. It is also worth mentioning that this was not the first music festival bannered as a punk festival, which took place in Europe. That distinction goes to the first European punk rock festival, which took place on Saturday, the 21st of August in 1976, at the Mont de Marsan Arena, which was a bullring just south of Bordeaux in France. It included a number of French acts as well as some English acts. The English acts that played at that event included Eddie and the Hot Rods, the Pink Fairies, the Tyler Gang, Nick Lowe, the Damned, and the Count Bishops. I will be highlighting many of those bands in some of the pre-punk specials that are coming up. And if you would like an excellent write-up about that particular festival, I can refer you, if you can find it, to a book by Carolyn Kuhn, who was one of the major punk scribes of the time. Some of her collected articles from Melody Maker from 76 and 77 appear in the book 1988, The New Wave Punk Rock Explosion. Now, there are audience recordings that exist of the sets by Siouxsie and the Banshees and The Clash and the Sex Pistols and The Damned from the 100 Punk Rock Special. However, they are of very, very poor quality. I'm going to play you a snippet of Siouxsie and the Banshees' performance of The Lord's Prayer. You'll understand why that I'm only playing a snippet and not providing full tracks from these recordings. So there you go, however you define it. These are pretty rough recordings, but then again, the historical importance of these recordings even existing is tremendous. So let's go over what the festival was like. Again, it started on September 20th, 1976 at 7 p.m. The first act up was Subway Sect. Subway Sect, in some ways, are the great lost band of the early punk years. Not counting a friend's party a couple of nights beforehand, this marked their first ever gig. And the lineup for the group at this early stage was 19-year-old Vic Goddard on vocals, Robert Miller on guitar, Paul Myers on bass, and Paul Packham on drums. They shared a rehearsal space with the Sex Pistols, and through Sex Pistols manager Malcolm McLaren's influence, got them on the bill for this particular evening. They were also very close to the Clash, and there are many stories about early Subway Sect gigs where Mick Jones had to tune the guitars for the band members because of their relative inexperience of playing their instruments. If you ever do see early live footage of Subway Sect, and there are some clips that do exist, you'll see a band that is very spiky and very frantic and very, very intense. For the evening, they were all dressed in gray jerseys and it gave a very utilitarian uniform look. They kicked off their set with the song No Love, which has this amazing lyric, "Love is not what we need, we're part of the UK." They were unashamedly pistol inspired, and by most accounts got the evening off to a very powerful start. The other songs in Subway Sect's set, try saying that three times fast, also included the songs Nobody's Scared, Contradictions, and Don't Split Up, and unfortunately it would be some time before people would be able to hear these songs again, either through a radio session or a record release, because of Subway Sect's sporadic record releases. Next up was Siouxsie and the Banshees. Again, their debut performance. As you heard in the clip I had played, they performed the Lord's Prayer, which was the only song they performed as part of their set, though it did include some snippets of Twist and Shout and Smoke on the Water and Deutschland über Alles. Siouxsie and the Banshees were formed out of the Bromley contingent, which, as I detailed in the previous episode, were a group of not necessarily groupies or hangers-on, but fans of the band that had coalesced around the Sex Pistols' early live shows, and were named the Bromley Contingent because of the suburban town that many of them were from. The original lineup of the Banshees included naturally Siouxsie Sue, real name Susan Ballion, on vocals, long mainstay Steve Severin on bass, Marco Peroni on guitar, later best known as Adam Ant's partner in crime, through the last incarnation of Adam the Ant into Adam's solo career, and one Sid Vicious on drums. The Clash had originally planned to let Siouxsie and the Banshees use their equipment during the 100 Club Festival, but when their manager, Bernie Rhodes, saw that Siouxsie was wearing a swastika armband, they withdrew their consent. Originally planning to perform the James Bond-themed Goldfinger, they opted at the last minute to perform the Lord's Prayer. Hell, the membership of the band had not coalesced until the night before, and continued to play it, again inserting snippets from other songs until they got bored about 20 minutes later. However chaotic this was, it was the start of a long and storied career. Then we get to The Clash. The Clash were formed when Joe Strummer, who was part of a pub rock band named the 101ers, basically imploded, and he hooked up with Mick Jones and Paul Simonon of an embryonic punk band in the early 1976 called London SS. This new group also brought in another guitarist, Keith Levine, who would later pop up in Public Image Limited, and at this point included Terry Chimes on drums. Keith Levine had just left the band days before, so this was their first performance as a four-piece. Their set list that night included songs that would become the framework of the Clash debut album the following year. Those included White Riot, London's Burning, I'm So Bored with the USA, 48 Hours, Janie Jones, and also included some much rarer tracks like How Can I Understand the Flies. They ended the set with their forward-looking song 1977. I will naturally be talking about The Clash in more detail in an upcoming episode, as well as Joe Strummer's pub rock band, the 101ers, as I will spotlight the only release that came out during that band's lifetime, Keys to Your Heart, which is a really powerful pre-punk song, I'll put it that way. You can hear that The Clash sound is almost there, but not quite. Then we go on to the headliners, the Sex Pistols. And like The Clash, they performed a set which later became the basis of their own debut album, Nevermind the Bollocks. The songs they played included Anarchy in the UK, No Feelings, Submission, 17, New York, Pretty Vacant, and they also provided a heavy smattering of cover songs, which included Don't Give Me the Lip, Child by Dave Barry, I'm Not Your Stepping Stone, best known from the Monkees version, but one that was actually originally recorded by Paul Revere and the Raiders, The Who's Substitute, and The Stooges' No Fun. Judging from the intense crowd reaction, it was very clear that the Sex Pistols at this point were no longer a secret band, and by that point, the bar was filled by record company types, checking out to see what all the buzz was about. The second night of the punk special kicked off with Stinky Toys, again a French band who were fronted by Ellie Medeiros. a singer who is still very active in France and Uruguay today. The band was rounded out by Jackno on rhythm guitar, Bruno Caron on lead guitar, Albin Dure on bass guitar, and Herve Zanuda on drums. Their set included a cover of The Stones' Under My Thumb, as well as originals such as Pepe Gestapo and Kill the Pain. They were the only band that really didn't connect with the crowd. They later signed to Polydor Records the following year in 1977. A first single named Boozy Creed was met pretty much with indifference, which caused Polydor to abandon any plans to release the band's debut album outside of France. Then we get to The Damned, consisting of lead vocalist Dave Vanian, guitarist Brian James, bassist Captain Sensible, and drummer Rat Scabies. The band had only been together for 3 months at this point. Their set included New Rose, which would later become their first single and the first true UK punk single to come out. However, their set is more notable for the number of beer glasses that were being thrown during their performance. One shattered and cut some people, and it was this aspect that was grabbed onto by the press. Some reported that it was Sid Vicious that actually threw it. An ambulance was called in, and the police were right behind, arresting both Sid Vicious and reporter Carolyn Kuhn. After The Damned, we see the Vibrators take the stage, with the original lineup including Knox on guitar, real name Ian Karkonen, Pat Collier on bass, John Ellis on guitar, and Eddie, real name John Edwards, on drums. They were originally a more R&B-inspired outfit, much older than most of the bands. The average age of the group members at this point was 28. And there were many factions in the early days that questioned their authenticity, primary among them Mark P. of the fanzine Sniffing Glue. The Vibrators were about to sign to Rack Records, which was a label overseen by Mickey Most, who was pretty much a pop impresario. And also part of Rack's stable was Chris Spedding. Chris at this time was a well-known session guitarist, and he had a top 20 solo hit in the UK the previous year with a song called Motorbikin'. As to his punk credentials, Chris also produced the first demos for the Sex Pistols, not to mention his role in producing the Vibrators' earliest recordings. 40 years on, the Vibrators are still very active as a touring unit, and they actually start a United States tour tonight as I'm recording this out in Colorado that will last through the end of October. And the band perform a set that is predominated by covers, including the Beatles' I Saw Her Standing There, the Rolling Stones' Jumping Jack Flash, earlier rock covers such as Great Balls of Fire and Let's Twist Again, and following Chris Spedding joining them on stage, his own Motorbiking. The second night of the 100 Club Punk special ends with a set from the Buzzcocks. We talked about the formation of the Buzzcocks in our previous episode. At this point, the band is vocalist Howard Devoto, guitarist Pete Shelley, Steve Diggle on bass, and John Marr on drums. Their set list included some of their earliest original songs, such as Breakdown, Orgasm Addict, Oh Shit, and Boredom. For many, many people, this was considered the moment that was the catalyst for things that developed in years to come. This was the gig that brought punks together from all over England to essentially rally for a cause. It made its mark in the press, and with the aforementioned violence during the Damned set, painted a picture of violence and disregard for authority that was somewhat a shadow over the early days of the punk movement. Now, I don't want to end the show without playing another track. Don't want to leave you with just that brief Siouxsie clip that I provided. So, to round the show out, I'm going to play a song from Subway Sect. It's going to be a long time before we play another Subway Sect track on this podcast, because we don't get a debut single from them until much, much later. But this is the B-side from that debut single. It was a song they performed that night, and it's called Don't Split It. So just imagine you're one of the 600 in this crowded club, and you're witnessing the coalescence of something wonderful.
Black.
For listening, there is a UKPNW at 40 podcast Facebook page, and please like that now that it is up and running. And also, please let people know about this podcast. If you want to reach out to me, then just hit me up via email at ukpnwat40@gmail.com. This is Bill Zanowitz, and I will be back again with another episode. Until that time, go out there and do it yourself.
Is she really going out with him?